Have you ever wondered, how do you get a new career after age 50? Well, by the end of this video, you're going to gain clarity for your personal retirement plan, and you're going to have action items to secure your retirement.
To learn more about securing your retirement and all the different elements you need to know, subscribe to our channel and hit the bell to be notified when we post a video every Monday. We have helped hundreds of our clients gain clarity and get on the path to a comfortable and happy retirement. Now it's your turn. Let's dive in.
Welcome, everyone, to our Monday podcast, where we are, our goal, Merce and I, is to bring to you benefit by having an expert that we can interview. And today we have done that again. We have with us Diane Ploice. And her background, and I'm going to have her explain a little bit more about it, but why we wanted to reach out to her and have her come on is because this idea of doing something else other than the career you might have done for years and years and years is a topic that Merce and I run across quite a bit as we help people plan for and live throughout retirement. And so we're going to ask her some questions on that. But first of all, let me just say this. Thank you so much, Diane, for coming on and talking with us today.
It's my pleasure. Happy to talk about franchising, and I appreciate the invitation.
Good. So now you said it, and I'm going to set it up a little bit here. Basically, what we run into is we've got a couple of different scenarios. We've got individuals that maybe without their choice were downsized. We've also got individuals because of their choice. They say, I don't want to be in this stressful career that they, you know, everything has changed. I don't like the management. Maybe they got bought out and they're saying, you know, I want to just get out of this world, but I'm not ready to retire. So we've got that one. Then we've also got the person who just wants something completely different. And it's really not about downsizing or anything like that. It's just, I want something different. And we've ran into all of those scenarios. Now, you focus on franchising. So can you just kind of give us a little bit of background, I guess, how you got into this and really what your particular niche is that you work with?
Sure. It was really by serendipity that I got into this. I had been in advertising and marketing previously. I have an MBA. 26 years ago, my husband and I moved to California on his job. I was the trailing spouse. I answered one newspaper ad, and it was for a marketing director for a franchise development company. The person who headed that up was recruited to become the president of a packaging and shipping franchise and brought me along as the marketing director. That was out of Denver, so for a couple of years I commuted. And then unfortunately, they fell on some hard times and I was laid off, as sometimes happens with the candidates. I was extremely fortunate in that I was invited to join FranChoice, which is a consortium of independent franchise consultants with deep roots in franchising. That was 16 years ago, almost 17 years ago, and I have enjoyed it immensely. I like helping people find that next opportunity, that career, listening to their goals, and seeing if a franchise would indeed be a fit for them.
Yeah, that's a great background, Diane, and thanks for sharing that. And so franchising, I mean, it's something that is very interesting to me because we visit franchises every single day, whether it's a fast food restaurant or a department store or shopping, whatever it is, it's very likely been franchised. That's really one of the biggest ways that a company can grow. And so the idea of getting into it from one side can be nerve-wracking, but from the other side could be very, very exciting. And I guess the first step someone has to make is make a decision on if they are interested in franchising. How do they even make a decision on what to franchise within? Is it, and I assume it can't be as simple as a statement of me saying, hey, I love French fries, so let me go buy a McDonald's or go buy 10 McDonald's, right? There's got to be way more to it to help that you, I assume, bring to the table, helping someone make that decision as to what could be a good fit for them for a franchise.
Yes, I focus on the person. What are their skills and what are their goals? What is their why? Why do they want to do a business? And a business is really a vehicle to get them somewhere. Is that financial security? Is that flexibility? Is that lifestyle? Is that generational growth? And depending upon what they want, their skills and their interests, then I will match companies to them. And the companies that I'll match, again, should be reflective of their interests. So just because a person likes French fries doesn't necessarily mean that they want a business that is 24/7, 365. They may say, gee, I came out of corporate America and I would like a business with traditional hours, or I would like a white collar business, or whatever the case is, or I want a business with high recurring revenue or with robust margins. So we'll talk about all of those types of things. We'll talk about their sales and marketing ability. We'll talk about their territory. So based on a number of different factors, I will come back to them with several options. Some they may be familiar with, some they may not be familiar with, and hopefully they will have an open and ready mind to look and learn about it and see if indeed it would be a good match.
Yeah, we were talking before we actually started recording, and we told you about an experience where we had a client who really ended up getting into a franchise that just didn't work. And I can't even remember all the reasons why he did what he did, but it kind of almost was just like he kind of came across something, heard about that one thing, decided he would try it, ended up not liking it, ended up not being a great experience for him. So from what you're describing with what you do, now, let's say that you do what you just said. You help us think through all these different steps, all these different things that were, you know, hey, I hear some options. And then I go and I look at those options. And then what's the next step? What do you do at that point to help me kind of continue down that path? Because to me, this is unknown territory.
Sure. And that's where hopefully a franchise consultant can be very beneficial. So I am not simply introducing you to companies and saying, fly, little birdie, fly. I am hopefully taking you by the hand and having weekly calls with you so that you can understand what the next steps are. So franchise companies have a process that they will take you through. They will start with the broad overview of how they got started, the background, the founders, where they're planning on going. Then they'll talk about their advertising and marketing program. They'll talk about their IT platform. They'll talk about their training and support. They'll talk about things that differentiate. Once they cover all of those types of things, then you'll usually have a dedicated call where you'll go through the legal document with them. That's called the franchise disclosure document. After that, usually if you like the company and they like you, it's a two-way street. They will give you the green light to chat with their franchisees, with their franchise owners. And really, you're asking questions about them and how they're running the business. What kind of margins are they having? How long did it take to get started? Any and all questions are always fair game. After that, again, if the franchise company likes you, they will invite you to what's called a confirmation day or a discovery day, sometimes also called a meet the team day. It can be in person or virtual. You'll meet the whole team, finalize any questions, and then you'll make a yes or no decision. So sometimes people jump the gun, if you will, and they say, I want to buy this or I'm going to buy that. Really, when they do a franchise investigation, the goal is to do a good investigation. And the result of that could be that they buy a franchise or they don't.
Gotcha. So there are clearly a few steps here that really is, it's really kind of due diligence on both sides, because you have to be approved by the company to be a franchise owner. And then you also want to be, you know, happy with the investment that you're about to make into the company. So yeah, and this is kind of going to lead into the next question is, it seems like it's a big investment. And so let's talk about that for a little bit. I imagine that and I know different companies have different valuation structures and everything like that, but there's got to be some type of standard as to, is there, I assume there's some type of buy-in and then maybe like an annual franchise fee. So just talk a little bit towards if someone's going to dive into this and they got you've been approved and they're ready to move forward, what do they have to be ready financially for?
When they sign the franchise agreement, they will need to write out a check, and that is for the franchise fee, which is a one-time fee. Franchise fees generally are in the $50,000 to $65,000 category. There are certainly some that are less and others that are six figures, But if you look at that mid-range point, that's a good starting point. And then from that, in that franchise disclosure document, they will detail all of the costs. For example, they will give a range of marketing and advertising spend for a minimum of the first 3 months. They'll include, for example, training, and that might be a flight, it might be hotel. So you'll look at that and say, oh, well, the franchise company happens to be close. I can drive there. So you can save a little money. Or you might say, oh, the franchise that is the best fit for me is across the country. So I know that I'm going to have this kind of an airplane ticket for that cost. They will go through that. If we look at what we call a service-based business that can be run out of an office suite, something that could be mobile or possibly a home office, generally, the total investment, and that would include the franchise fee and everything to get started for a minimum of 3 months, that's probably going to be in that $75,000 to $150,000, $200,000 range. If we look at anything that is brick and mortar, total investment, again, including that one-time franchise fee, is usually going to start at about $300,000 and go up from there. Franchise companies want you to have skin in the game. They will usually want you to come with about 30% of that investment to the table and be able to finance the balance. So usually when I am coaching and guiding a person through that investigation process and telling them what to expect and coaching them with questions to ask, ideally we'll look at how are they going to fund the business as well so that they can align that with when it comes time to make a decision. I would hate to ever have a candidate miss out on an opportunity because they didn't have their funding in order and someone else sees that it's a great opportunity and they have their funding done and they are awarded that franchise.
Very good. So now, you know, with Merce and I, when we're with our, I don't know, with probably a lot of our listeners, I know with our clients, the people we work with the most, a lot of them are professionals. They're very well educated. They have made good money in their work. They've been good savers, so they have a capital to invest, but many of them have not been business owners. That's not what been their thing. Now we've had some that have transitioned from work into consulting. We've had that happen, but is there, when you think about what it is that I have to have and what it is I'm talking here, mental capacity, like, you know, what does it take to be a good franchise owner? Do I have to have already been a business owner in order to be a good franchise owner?
You don't have to have been a business owner. One of the very nice things about franchising is you usually don't need industry experience. Most of the time, they would prefer to teach you and teach you their way. So if we look at something like a hair salon business, they don't want you to be the stylist. They want you to be the business person that can run and manage that business. You may have heard the term that in franchising, you can work on the business and not necessarily in the business. So if you look at purchasing a hair salon, you would not get your cosmetology license, but you would be hiring, recruiting the stylist, you would be marketing, could be involved in the community. And usually a business like that, you'll grow and scale. So you might start with one and then grow it to two or three within 2 or 3 years. You might grow it to 10. If you're an empire builder, you might have 100. So it's totally different than a job mentality. You're thinking as a business owner, what are those transferable skills? Do you have management experience? Are you good with people? How about customer service? Are you familiar with financials? Do you enjoy those types of things? And are you coachable? Do you have that ready and willing and open mind to learn and to be that great business owner and have control for yourself and somewhat put your personal stamp on things and say, I had guidance and support, but I also did this. I brought a lot to the table.
Yeah. And so, So for that person that is coachable, but really has no self-employment history or experience. So someone that maybe came out of a professional role at a tech company or whatever it is, and they wanted to go into this franchise concept. There's a lot of things that you mentioned. So go with the hair salon. The first part of it is, I guess, finding the location, where to put that, and then also then filling it with people that can cut hair. And then also on top of that, there's marketing. And you've got this person that is coachable and could probably figure it out. But what type of support is the franchise providing someone that really has no idea how to hire a salon or a hairstylist, or no idea how to, in the world of marketing that we're in right now, to have an effective marketing plan?
Sure. That's where the franchise companies really shine. They will, in the discovery process, they will share all of that information with you. And you look at some of these companies that have done it over and over again. The beauty is they have fine-tuned it and honed it. So you're coming in and they're saying, this is our program, and they expect that you're going to not have any familiarity. So they're going to take you from step one and walk you through that. And when you look at a franchise company, you're looking at how robust their training and support program is. That's one of the things, one of the benefits, and one of the things that you get when you buy a franchise.
Would you say that the support and the training program would kind of align as to with what your initial investment is going to be?
I would not make that association necessarily. I don't believe that just because you invest more in a franchise that their training or support might be better. I believe that good franchise companies, high road franchise companies, have exceptional training and support. That's what they're known for. That's what they take pride in. They want to get that new business owner up and operative as soon as possible. They know that happy franchisees are successful, and they will bring in more happy franchisees. So they want to do everything possible to make that new owner successful in a reasonable amount of time. Just like there's no direct correlation between what you invest and what you make, nor is there a direct correlation between your educational level and what you can achieve. So for the person that maybe has only a GED, but they have that fire in the belly and they say, give me that toolbox, let me go, I can execute, I'm great with people, they can build a thriving business. The opportunity is there.
So as I sit here and listen about this, I'm a business owner. Merce is a partner with me. And so we understand the concept of running a business, and, you know, and we understand the need to have good support in a lot of different ways in order to have that. So as I listen to you, honestly, I had really never even thought about the idea of a franchise as for somebody to do that, maybe as that second career or that in, you know, that thing that's a little different than what they've done for all the 20, 30 years. So now I do also remember, though, when I would travel, there used to be, and it might still be there, it was a magazine that would have all these different franchises in it. And I had seen that before, and I'd flip through and see all these different franchises. And I would think to myself, well, how in the world would you even know what to do? And how would you even know what is a good franchise or not a good franchise? So it sounds like, just listening to you, that you've obviously got a tremendous amount of knowledge and benefit here. But what would you say sets you apart from maybe other, or maybe the general of what somebody might get when they either A, try to do it on their own, or B, try to get another franchise consultant?
Well, sometimes when people try to do it on their own, they unfortunately don't get very far. They hit a little submit button online that says, I'm interested. And if the franchise company has territory available, or if they meet the minimum financial requirements, they may hear from them or they may not. Many times I have people call me and they say, help, I tried to get information online and no one responded. It's someone like the resume that goes into the black hole. They're saying, I would like to learn more and no one is responding. Or they click for some information and they get deluged with info from all other companies that they have zero interest in. So there's only so much info you can gain online. Really, you need to be either working with someone like me or talking directly with a franchise company to get that information, the detail that you need. And it's not like buying a stock that you might advise. Again, you're looking at the culture and the fit. You want to make sure that the management team has your best interests and that they're forward looking and they will continue to be ahead of that curve. Not every franchise company, unfortunately, is good. And sometimes we use the term franchise infatuation when the person loves the French fries and that's why they want to buy the business. I don't think that's really a lasting good decision. I also work with some of those reluctant entrepreneurs that don't know the franchising world. They don't know the business world. So the nice thing about doing a franchise investigation is they can somewhat try that on when they're talking to other franchise owners. Are they like them? Do they have a similar background? Can they assimilate with them? And if they can, that's a very good sign. And if they can't, well, maybe they shouldn't be a business owner. And sometimes I talk with people and really three things can happen. They can move forward with the franchise. They can tell me, no, this isn't right. Or I will politely tell them, I don't think it's a good fit. So those are the scenarios.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know, as financial advisors and we work in the world of investments, a big part of what we do is we have to manage expectations as far as, you know, maybe we had a really good year, an outstanding and above average type of year, and we don't want clients to expect while we know we are good at what we do, they're going to get that year every single year. And so managing expectations is really important. And I imagine as a franchise consultant, it's very important on your end as well, as far as, you know, making sure the person that's going into this deal knows that it's going to take some time maybe before you become profitable, and what type of expectation should that be? So how do you do that? And then also the second part of this is for the listeners out there to get real to them, you know, what's their, if they went down this franchise road, what does their typical day kind of look like?
Sure. So you had two questions in there.
Big
and
ones.
And let me go back to the first question again and help me remind me of that first question again.
Yeah, really. How do you manage their expectations when they're diving into this idea, really from a profitability perspective, I guess?
Sure. Again, they will hear from the franchise company certain expectations of what it will take. So the franchise company can share information as long as it is in their legal document, their franchise disclosure document. But when you call up a franchisee, you can ask them and say, hey, Bob, how long did it take you to hit break even? And what are you doing now? And again, I coach and help them so that they're building rapport with that person first. It's similar to, let's say, a job interview. You don't go to a job interview and just say, well, how much do you pay? What's the salary here?
Right.
You talk about what you can bring. So likewise, when I coach and work with the candidates, I am helping them ask these questions in a way so that they can get the information they need. And they're going to have a range of expectations. But as they talk with people, they might say, you know, I really connected with David or with Mary, and they're one of their rock star franchisees. And what they're doing, I would feel comfortable doing. It's nothing out of the ordinary. If they connect with Sam, who is struggling, maybe that's not such a good fit then, or maybe they shouldn't be a business owner. So they will sometimes look at things, or I've also heard them say, gee, I talked with Sarah and, you know, Sarah is doing this and I think I could run it much better. I see opportunity here. I see opportunity there. So they will start to get a feel. What they won't know is what is their work ethic and what are they bringing to the table. If they've been successful before, I like to think that a tiger doesn't change its stripes and they will continue with that good work ethic in their business and not sit on the couch and eat bonbons or watch daytime TV.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's great. And then, so what does the typical day look for a franchise owner?
It certainly will depend upon the franchise. And in some companies, the franchisee might be the artisan, so they could be performing the services. In other franchises, they will be managing the employees. They could be involved in the community. They could be planning their advertising or marketing. Again, we talk about what we call a day in the life. So they will first hear what that day in the life is from that franchise company, and they'll be able to verify that with the franchisee.
That's good. Now I got one final question before we conclude here and go into how people can get in touch with you. If you had to describe right now out of the world of franchising, because it's been around for a long time, why would you say that it's a good option for people to consider franchising today, 2021?
It's an excellent option because money is cheap. Since this is a financial show, you probably see that, and it is readily available. There is pent-up demand, but maybe more importantly, the world and the landscape has changed. People have started working from home, and they've realized, I have additional options and choices. So they might say, I no longer want to work for another company. I would like my hard work and effort to benefit me and my family rather than shareholders somewhere. So people have those choices that they can now make and probably feel much more comfortable with. Also, I believe communities like to support local business owners, and I think that will continue.
Yeah, I agree there. Diane, thank you so much for hopping on today and having a conversation with us. Clearly, you have a wealth of knowledge when it comes to franchising and helping people figure out whether or not it's a good option for them and also which direction to go in. So if someone's listening to this and they say, you know, this seems like this could be something that I'd like to look into, what would be the best way for them to reach out to you?
They can reach out to me several different ways. My website is dianeploise.com. You can find me on LinkedIn under Diane Ploise, the Franchise Fitter. Since my last name is A, difficult to pronounce, and B, difficult to spell, I will spell it. It is P as in Peter, L-E-U-S-S. Or you can simply go to quickchatwithdiane.com and book a short call with me.
Very nice.
My services are also free, and I work nationwide.
Great. So we will make sure we have all that information on our website as well as on the show notes. And we would just like to say thank you so much for all of your time and your knowledge that you've shared with us today.
Thank you very much. It was my pleasure. If you have any follow-up questions, be happy to answer them and be a resource. That's what I try to be, is be that trusted resource for the people I work with.
We hope this video has given you some confidence and clarity as you plan for a worry-free life in retirement. But what else do you need? We have created a complimentary video course called 3 Keys to Secure Your Retirement. This video walks you through step-by-step what you need to do to get ready for retirement. You can also check out our podcast called Secure Your Retirement. You can subscribe below.
For more retirement tips, watch this video. Create your retirement income plan. Also, click here to subscribe to our podcast, Secure Your Retirement. If you like this video, hit the like button and be sure to subscribe and share it with your friends.